I'm Dr. Turi King. I'm a geneticist at the University of Leicester and a lecturer in genetics and archaeology there. Genetics is pretty fundamental. It's the sort of thing it can tell you about genetic makeup of populations in the past. It can also tell you about disease genes and how the frequencies of those have changed over time. I mean, I think it's just a fundamental subject. It tells us about where we came from and how we've evolved through time.
Hi, I'm Matthew Morris. I'm an archaeologist for the University of Leicester. Richard III is notable for a number of reasons, but he's notable because he's the last king of the Plantagenet dynasty in England. He's the last English king to die in battle. And thanks to Shakespeare's play about him, he's sort of this semi-mythical figure, this vile, evil tyrant that attracts lots of sort of popular myths and legends and makes him this really interesting character to study. So when we started looking for Richard in 2012 and the church that he'd been buried in, we could have encountered hundreds of human remains buried in that church, and it was being able to separate one out of that mass of human remains that was going to be difficult. The identification process for Richard III is like any sort of forensic case. It's not based on one sole strand of evidence alone. You have to take everything into account, from the archaeology to the analysis of the skeleton itself, the bones, trauma on the bones, all the injuries he'd received in battle, to carbon dating the remains to make sure that this skeleton was someone who died around about 1485.
Being able to sequence the DNA of somebody who was alive all those many years ago, one of our genetic cousins, that's been one of the really big landmark discoveries. And also this next generation sequencing technology, which now allows us to look in depth at the DNA of individuals in the past.
So you couldn't prove it was Richard III on any one strand of evidence, but when you put it all together, the answer we came up with is it can't be anyone else, it has to be Richard III. The public's reaction to the discovery has been amazing. I don't think going into this project we had any concept of how amazing it would be and how global it would be. It seems to have caught everybody's imagination, this story.
I'm really interested in doing some more work on Richard. Some of the things you can do is looking at things like DNA from the calculus, so that stuff that the dentist scrapes off when you go to the dentist, actually in there you can get a lot of DNA, and you can look at things like Richard's diet and things like that. But also doing wider studies, looking at the peopling of Britain using ancient DNA to look at actually remains of individuals from the period, I think would be a really interesting thing to do. I think it's an emerging field, essentially. It's the new technologies are allowing us to do so much more now. So we're at the start of this, I think, a real wave in being able to use genetics to look at ancient events in the past.
I get asked what's next a lot of times, and sort of how can you top finding a King of England?
The big thing will actually probably be sort of more of the same. It's whole genome sequencing of individuals from the past. And that's really cool because you can look at the genetic makeup of populations, but you can also look at how the frequency of particular genes have changed through time, which is really interesting.
Whenever there's a new building going up in Leicester or in England, I might be one of those archaeologists out there excavating it, and that's the fun bit, because you never know what you're going to find next. It could be absolutely nothing, but it could be another King of England. You don't know. You just don't know what's going to be under the ground, and that's the fun of it.